Well, you can see it's a beautiful October day. I'm at State Game Lands over in eastern Cumberland County. You can see the change of the colors and the leaves in the background. As I came into the parking lot, a ringneck pheasant rushed across the parking lot. And you can see that there's a family here, a father and a young son that are going out for pheasant hunting season. And the state stocks pheasants for hunting every year. I'm going to be going up this mountain ridge behind me to a very well-known hawk an eagle watching spot called Wagner's Gap. The weather's perfect. It's temperatures in the high 50s. There's a northwest wind, which is perfect for the hawk migration as the hawks come down the ridges of the Appalachian Mountains migrating south. It is the third week in October, so we're beginning to see more golden eagles starting to move through the area. And also I saw a sharp-shinned hawk fly over, which is another type of a hawk that I'll be talking about.
This presentation is about Pennsylvania fall hawk migration. And as we'll see in this presentation, Pennsylvania is a unique place for observing and recording scientific information about hawks in North America. In my discussion today, I'll be talking about several things. I'll be talking about why hawk watching is a popular fall activity here in Pennsylvania and throughout the Northeast U.S. I'll be answering the question, where do people watch hawks in the fall? How do hawks fly when they migrate and where do they go? How do you identify migrating raptors? Raptors is the term for hawks, falcons, eagles, and vultures, all birds of prey. And what raptors do we see in Pennsylvania? Do hawk watchers keep records? And who uses the data? And finally, how many raptors migrate through Pennsylvania each year? And what are the total populations of some of these birds? If we look here at this map on the left, you can see the purple and red coloring shows where the Appalachian Valley and mountains pass through the Northeast U.S., and hawks migrate from northeast to southwest through the mountain ranges of the Appalachians. On the right, we can see that two of the major mountain ranges here are the Blue Mountain and Kittatinny Ridges. Hawk watchers line up along different locations there as the hawks move from northeast to southwest. So in that sense, the Appalachian Mountains of Pennsylvania are like a hawk superhighway for migration. If we look at this map of southeastern Pennsylvania, you can see the hawk watches start in the northeast at the Delaware Water Gap. Further southwest is Bake Oven Knob, north of Hamburg, Pennsylvania. And just southwest of there is Hawk Mountain with the famous Hawk Mountain Sanctuary. There's a hawk watch at Second Mountain at Fort Indian Town Gap. And then Wagner's Gap, which is a major hawk watching location in Cumberland County along the border of Perry County. The red star there shows where Hawk Mountain is. And Hawk Mountain has a sanctuary that's been there since 1934. It's the oldest, largest, member-supported raptor conservation organization in the world. It's internationally famous for research and conservation. And it's a scientific research center that participates in international research and training of scientists and educating the public and schools. It's also a great spot for tourists, and many ecotourists come from all over the country, especially the Northeast, to watch hawks there in the fall. So how do hawks fly during the migration? If you look at this diagram, fall westerly winds come and hit the Appalachian Mountains, and it creates a rising air current that the raptors use for flying during fall migration. This is looking below a kettle of hawks, and a kettle is a column of hawks that circle in a pattern like a tornado. And as the air rises upward, they circle in that upward air current like an escalator, which increases the hawk's elevation. After they achieve a higher elevation or higher altitude, they then coast downward, as you can see with this arrow. And how far can they migrate in one day? You may find this hard to believe, but in one day, raptors, hawks, and eagles, other birds, they can migrate 200 to 300 miles in one day. Well, how do we identify migrating raptors? You can see on the right, this is a chart of the common hawks seen in eastern North America. And notice there's different sizes, shapes, and color patterns. If we look from below, even when the lighting is poor, we can see the different shapes of the different types of raptors, from falcons on the right and the hawks. On the left, we have eagles and vultures. So this is how we identify them. We look at the shape of the bird, its body shape, its tail, its wings. We look at size and color, although color is difficult usually because they're flying at a distance. And then we look at behavior. How do they fly? What's that pattern? What's the rhythm? How do they hold their wings? So you can see here right away, even if I couldn't identify these birds up close, I can tell pretty much what category they are looking at the silhouette. Well, let's take a look at the major groups of hawks and eagles. On the upper left, we have birds called accipiters. When they fly, you can see that their pattern is like a cross shape with a longer body and wings that aren't quite as long. The next category, buteos, which includes the red tail and broadwing hawks, they have wide wings with a wedge-shaped body. And then falcons are easily identifiable because they have pointed wings and a longer tail. In the lower left, you can see the turkey vulture, which is easy to spot because of the slight V shape of the wing when they fly. And they're usually more wobbly because even though they're large birds, they're very light. And then the osprey in the middle has a slight M shape to its wing when it flies. And then bald eagles have a flat wing plane when they're flying. You can see it's completely flat, not like the vultures that have a V shape. So what raptors do we see in Pennsylvania? There's quite a variety. When we look at hawks, we have falcons on the left, accipiters, which are woodland hawks, very good at flying through thick forests, and buteos, or the broadwing hawks. Here are the falcons we have in eastern North America. We have the peregrine falcon, which is the largest on the left. In the middle, we have the merlin, which primarily nests in Canada and comes south in the winter. And then we have the small kestrel, which is the smallest of the falcon family that you can usually see around farmlands. They feed on small birds, insects, and mammals. All of these birds are carnivores and predators that feed on other birds and animals. The peregrine falcon is the fastest animal in the world. In fact, when they are hunting and go into a stoop, which is what you're seeing on the right, they make their body in a bullet shape, they can fly over 200 miles per hour.
One of the big things in fall migration is the migration of raptors. And of course, raptors are hawks, eagles, falcons. And I'm over at the Hummel Nature Trail. I'm taking a walk here. It's at the end of the first week of September. And if you look up behind me here, you can see some power lines. And as I was walking through here counting fall birds, I saw a peregrine falcon land up there. He's up on top there. Let me see. I can show you the tower here. It's really hard to see, but if you look up on the top one of those towers, you can see a little dot. That's a peregrine falcon. I got some good pictures with my camera, and I'll be talking about him and some of the other hawks and eagles that we see during the fall migration. Well, we can see these power lines here in Hummelstown. And way up top there, if we zoom in, you can see a peregrine falcon. See him up there? And he's migrating through right now. He was feeding on a mourning dove up there.
The next category of hawks is called buteos. These are larger, bulkier hawks than falcons. They tend to have broader, wider wings, which make them ideal for soaring. The most common one that we see here in Pennsylvania is the red-tail hawk, you can see on the left. This is the one that you usually see along roadsides or along telephone poles. They're quite large. They're much bigger and bulkier than a crow, and they're very trainable. People that are interested in falconry oftentimes train red-tail hawks. The next one that is also common and has one of the biggest numbers in terms of migration every fall is the broadwing hawk. This is more of a woodland hawk, and they live in the northeast U.S. and migrate all the way south to Central and South America. We'll talk about that in a minute. And this one was photographed up in northern Dauphin County, Pennsylvania. And then there's the red shoulder hawk. Unfortunately, when I took this picture in Florida, I got a nice shot of the red shoulder on the hawk. They're a very common hawk that you see very frequently in Florida, and they move through the area, and some actually nest and stay in Pennsylvania. So let's take a look at the broadwing hawk. You can see in the middle there, this is a map of the Western Hemisphere of the Americas, and the broadwing hawk nests all over North America. These birds migrate south over the Appalachian Mountains and other flyways, and then move along down through Mexico into Central America, and others head all the way south into South America, all the way down into Brazil and Argentina. On the right with those colored lines, these are actually birds that have been tracked by scientists. Each colored line is a different bird, and you can see how they migrate over the Appalachian Mountains down through Texas, Central America, and then these birds down into Western South America, into Peru, Bolivia, Colombia, and Ecuador. So looking at this map here, you can see birds gather from all over North America and then come down these flyways. These green lines are major flyways or routes. If you look on the right side of the screen, you can see there's a yellow line to the right where it says Hawk Mountain. And some birds actually, depending on the weather, will fly over Florida and the Caribbean or even over the Atlantic Ocean. The next category of hawks is called excipitors. Excipitors are woodland hawks, as I showed earlier. They have longer bodies. Their wings are a little bit stubbier. And these long tails on the birds that you can see here allow them to navigate very skillfully through thick forests where they can dodge trees and catch prey, such as mice and other birds. The largest is the North American goshawk. This bird is actually found in Northern Europe and Eurasia also. It's the rarest of the birds, and at least in Pennsylvania and the U.S., it's a bird that's struggling with numbers. The next one in the middle is called a Cooper's hawk, and this is a very common bird we see around neighborhoods. I call them the bird feeder hawk because I've had a pair in my home area that likes to hang out in trees and swoop down and pick up some of the birds from the bird feeders. That's probably the most common hawk that we see. And then its smaller cousin, which is very similar. They're almost impossible to identify unless you get the size. That's a smaller excipitor, and we have large numbers of those that come through the area during the fall hawk migration. Another interesting hawk that comes through during migration is called the harrier. It used to be called the marsh hawk. And if any of you have ever heard of the Harrier jet fighter, and you can see a picture in the lower right section of your screen, the Harrier is a bird that can hover very skillfully over marshlands and fields and spot its prey and then drop down. So its ability to hover is what this jet fighter is imitating, and that's why they're called Harrier jets. They have a long, sleek body with fairly long wings. They live mainly, you can see, in Canada and northern U.S., and come down through our area and spend the winters in the southern U.S. and Florida. The males are a beautiful gray, and the females are a more camouflaged brown color. The next bird is called the osprey. And just like the harrier, the military uses an aircraft named after this bird called the osprey. It's been largely used by the U.S. Marine Corps. And you can see in this picture on the left, these birds are very good at hovering, and they can hover over water. They are sometimes called a fish eagle, and then swoop down and grab fish out of the water. They actually go under the water a little bit to get the fish. And as you can see, they're mainly in the northern U.S., but we do have some here nesting in Pennsylvania, and they migrate south into central Mexico, Central America, and South America. This is a pair in the middle here that was establishing a family on a huge nest that's probably about 10 or 12 feet wide on a pylon in the inland waterway of Florida. You can see their long curved bills for ripping the flesh of fish. And in the upper right is a picture I took in Florida of one that was eating a fish that it caught in a canal. Notice the feet on the lower right corner. Unlike most birds of prey that have three talons in the front and one in the back, they have two in the front and two in the back, which makes it easier for them to catch fish.
Well, it's a rainy afternoon, 3:30. I'm up at Fort Indiantown Gap, and as you can see, the beautiful scenery in the background. This is one of the hawk watching spots along the Kittatinny Ridge in Pennsylvania. And thanks to the support of the U.S. military, federal government, and conservationists, there's been a hawk watch here since 1984 atop Second Mountain. And as you can see, there's a nice parking area. People come up here to observe and count hawks. And this is a wonderful place for hawk watching and easy access for those of us who live in the Hershey, Lebanon area. I'll walk across the parking lot here, and we can see where the hawk counters usually sit. But as I said, it's raining right now, and the weather is poor, so the hawk counters have left for the day. There's usually one or two volunteers here on a regular basis that come up, count hawks, and it's reported to the website that I showed also in my presentation. This is the spot where the counters usually sit. And as you can see in the background, it's beautiful scenery and a wonderful place to come, even just to enjoy the fall foliage.
Well, as I just discussed, Fort Indiantown Gap, it seems like a strange place to have bird watching. But as you can see the sign here, Second Mountain Hawk Watch, which is established in 1984, is right on the Fort Indiantown Military Reservation, which is the home of the Pennsylvania National Guard. And it's interesting to go bird watching there or hawk watching, because when you drive into the property and head to some of these locations, you see signs like this: warning, artillery or mortar firing is being conducted when red flag is being flown or red light is on. And it's interesting that they do have live fire exercises with machine guns and mortars and bazookas. They have airplanes that come in and drop bombs. And because of that, they have a whole conservation and biology staff that manages the environment there, and they have controlled burns every couple of years to keep the brush down so that it doesn't trigger wildfires in the land that's there. So when we look at the second mountain hawkwatch, one of the birds that we see most frequently year-round, especially during hawk migration, are vultures. The vultures are nature's cleanup crew. And if you've all seen animals on the side of the road, you'll see a vulture coming down and picking it apart. And they have an important role. Even though they're kind of an ugly bird, they help clean up all of the dead animals and carcasses that we find around in our environment. On the upper left and the lower and the center bottom, you see the turkey vulture. And you can see from its appearance why it gets its name. It does kind of look like a turkey, but they have those bizarre, ugly, pink, red-colored heads with a very hooked, thick beak, which they can use to rip through carrion flesh and pick bones with that. And why do vultures have bald heads? Well, the answer is simple, is oftentimes when they're feeding on animal carcasses, there may be blood or other slimy materials. And by not having feathers there, the materials fall off the bird's head instead of getting stuck in feathers and maybe leading to some type of an infection. On the right is the black vulture. And black vultures are more of a southern species vulture, but easy to distinguish because they have a black colored head. They also fly differently than the turkey vultures, and their bodies are a little shorter and stubbier. Well, I want to bring up turkey vultures because there's an interesting phenomenon with their migration. As you can see on the right map there, there's a gold star. And this is Veracruz, Mexico, which is a major hawk watching site in Central America. As we saw with the broadwing hawks, some species of hawks migrate to South America. So they all have to go through Mexico and Central America. Well, at the Veracruz raptor observation site, you can see on October 21st, 2020, 113,239 birds, turkey vultures, over 100,000 turkey vultures were counted in one day. In one day, over 100,000 turkey vultures flew over there and migrated south. As you can imagine, with the weather getting colder in North America, the food availability is not very good. But of course, when they head into the southern hemisphere and the tropics, there's warm weather. In our winter months, it's the summer in South America, and there's plenty of food and carrion for them to feed on down there. How about eagles? Well, we have two types of eagles in Pennsylvania. We have the bald eagle on the left that everybody knows. It's our nation's bird. And then we have the golden eagle on the right, which gets its name from those yellow golden feathers that you can see on the side of the bird's neck. Bald eagles live mainly in the northern U.S. and Alaska. Some are year-round nesters. Along, you can see the rivers and mountains of North America. But many do migrate south in the winter, especially from Canada, because as the water freezes over, they cannot get their primary food source, which is fish, because the ice freezes over the tops of the water and they can't hunt for fish. Now, one of our local tourist attractions in central Pennsylvania is the Conowingo Dam. And every winter, hundreds of bald eagles from the Northeast US and Canada come down to this area below the dam because the water released from the dam never freezes over, and these birds have all winter access to fish for fishing. This is an eagle on the right that has caught a shad below the dam. And on any given day in the winter, there are dozens and dozens of eagles there, bald eagles. And on some days, you can see 150 eagles in one day. They are also one of Pennsylvania's great conservation stories. The Pennsylvania Game Commission introduced bald eagles back into Pennsylvania in the early 1980s. there were only three pairs of bald eagles nesting in Pennsylvania in the early 1980s. And then between 1983 and 89, the Game Commission started an eagle reintroduction program. By 1990, not even 10 years later, there were eight active nests. In 2000, 48 active nests. 2008, almost after 25 plus years of conservation efforts, there were 150 nesting pairs in Pennsylvania. We had 270 nesting pairs. That's at least 540 birds plus their young in 2013 and today. There are too many birds to even count here in Pennsylvania. A great success story. Now, the golden eagle, as you can see, is primarily a western bird. You can see in the summer months, they are up in northwestern Canada and Alaska, and then they move south in the winter. But that purple area there in the Rocky Mountains shows where these birds live year-round. In the east, we have a population in northeastern Canada that migrates south in the winter down through the Appalachian Mountains, although you can see little red dots in upstate New York and Maine where there are some birds that nest at higher altitudes in the mountains.
Well, I'm headed up to Wagner's Gap Hawk Watch, and as you can see here, typical for the Appalachian Mountains in Pennsylvania, there's a lot of rocks. In fact, this part of the Appalachian Trail in Pennsylvania is known as Rocksylvania. So I'll be hiking up top there to see what's going on. There's a lot of cars here today, a lot of hawk watchers, and we'll see what's up there. This is on top of Wagner's Gap, where the hawk watch is. That's looking northward to Perry County. Each year from September to November, people count the hawks here, which is reported to an international website.
Well, this is a view, a panoramic view atop Wagner's Gap Hawk Watch. On the left, you can see people standing there with binoculars and spotting scopes. This is looking northward into Perry County. And the hawks and eagles and other birds, falcons, they come down across the mountains there. And usually birds are seen on this north or northeast side of the hawk watch. And let's take a look now at the bird populations. We saw some of these earlier. How many birds are seen there in a year? This is a picture of hawk watchers at Hawk Mountain, and people that participate in the hawk counts, they record data onto a website called Hawk Count. It's part of the Hawk Migration Association of North America's Raptor Migration Database. And those charts, the chart that you see there is summary data for all the different species of hawks and eagles that were recorded on for the month of October in 2020 at Wagner's Gap. Let's take a look. What are those numbers like? We'll go back and look at 2019, because that season has already been completed. Turkey vultures, they counted 1,148 birds in 2019. How big is that compared to the world population? There are 4.5 million turkey vultures in the Americas, because as I said, they live in North, Central, and South America. They only had 26 black vultures at the count, but there's 4.26 million black vultures in the world. Why is that number so small? These are mainly a southern bird found in the southern U.S., Central, and Northern South America. So a lot of these numbers depend on where the bigger population of the bird lives. If they migrate south at a certain time, the numbers are bigger. If the birds are southern, mainly southern birds, we don't see as many. How about peregrine falcons? Well, as you can see, the peregrine falcon, which it not too long ago was an endangered species, they counted 48 birds flew over Wagner's Gap in 2019. And they estimate there's about 1,650 nesting pairs in Pennsylvania, which is puts it probably at about 4,000 peregrine falcons in North America. That's not too many. And then the American kestrel on the right here, I'm bringing that up. It's only 168 birds observed at the Hawk Watch in 2019. Total population is 9.2 million. However, this is a bird that has suffered greatly from pesticides and agriculture. They have declining numbers, and we may lose as much as 50% of the American kestrels by the year 2075 at the current rate of decline. Most of the birds of prey, as I did research, have either stable or growing populations and haven't been as heavily affected as a lot of the other songbirds and grass birds that we're seeing a major decline in North America. How about the Buteos? Well, in 2019, they counted 1,788 red-tail hawks at the Wagner's Gap Hawk Watch. Total population's about 2 million birds. And broadwing hawks, as I said, that's a big migrant. They had 6,636 birds fly over Wagner's Gap in 2019. And the world population of broadwings is about 1,800 birds. How about the eagles? Look on the left at the bald eagle. This is amazing. They counted 695 bald eagles at Wagner's Gap in 2019. There's an estimate of about 150,000 birds of bald eagles that live in North America. There's good news here. This is a bird that is increasing its population. Now, the golden eagle, much rarer bird, but still, they counted 119 golden eagles that flew over Wagner's Gap in 2019. The population of golden eagles in the U.S. is about 30,000, but as you can see, this is a bird that's found on the European and Asian continents, and worldwide there's about 200,000 golden eagles. This is a famous bird in Mongolia. It's a huge bird, but the Mongols have used golden eagles for falconry or hunting for thousands of years.
Well, I hope you've enjoyed this presentation on Pennsylvania fall hawk migration. As we can see with the changing colors behind me, the seasons keep changing, and therefore the birds that we get to observe keep changing with the seasons. And that's one of the most interesting and exciting parts about birds and birding, is how things keep changing. There's a lesson in that about nature and the universe and the way everything keeps changing. But amidst it all is our good and God creator that creates this beauty and gives us a wonderful planet, plants, and animals to enjoy. And until our next birding presentation, I'm Reverend Howard West, Executive Director of Spiritual Life, and keep looking for those birds.